You don't know how I was raised, you wouldn't understand. Not at all. Six of us in a two-bedroom apartment. Figure it out. I'm just on a mission. Bitch started out a kid, lot of ambition. On my birthday, never got what I was wishing for. Daddy wasn't dead, I didn't miss him though. Didn't blame him either, it was the norm to us. I mean, none of my friends had daddies either. I was raised by Erie Avenue. We young, carry burners, they'll bury you. So at a young age, I learned to fight for mines. Cause I wasn't gonna be that scary dude. Getting picked on, getting fucked with. It happened one time, I was like, fuck this. I went to Zeddy house, got his brother 38.
You wanna grab that piece. You wanna grab that piece, cause your fight game wasn't really that.
Stop playing, man.
You wanna grab that piece, then you call me. I need you to, I got a little issue, I'll be, hey.
I'm gonna hit you with a goddamn.
That was trying to give me one by Gilly the Nut and featuring Pusha T. That's a, you know, that's a classic. But I will say, you're now tuned into $1 million worth of game.
I go by the name of Gilly the King.
I go by the name of the
Grandmaster of all nut ass niggas.
Yeah, whatever. Wallow267. And have you had any good hair lately? First of all, we always get into this, you know, Everything Diva Glam, our sponsor. We want to always shout them out
everything
from the rip. And we still, me and Gil still working on them toupee wave caps. They coming out there. Listen, they're going to make a splash. I'm thinking even about investing in them because there's a lot of bald dudes that just say you want to go out at night, you want to do the town, you want to throw some waves on.
There's a lot of bald men out here that's living in the past. Their whole life is a throwback Thursday.
Yeah.
And they're dying to get there.
No, some people in denial that they got a, you know, convertible.
See, the worst joint. Oh, let me ask you, what's the question? When your hair is leaving you, right? Which one is worse? Is it worse when your front goes back, or when you get the bird nest right there in the middle?
No,
pigeon can land on your shit.
When the convertible just started whistling, because you can hide that. Like, you can really hide that.
No, I think that's the worst. When you get that. That joint right there, the bird nest right there.
Nah, you could wear it at a BC or like a little.
No, what's his name? He was the Beijing King when he just put a little Beijing there.
Yeah, I could paint my shit black.
I never in my life.
He was the Beijing King.
Okay, let me just tell you something. To all you niggas out here that still put Beijing in your shit,
it's a lot of
2019,
dudes.
It's a lot of niggas.
A lot of dudes doing that.
That still put the black shit in your head,
young boys,
and your
doing
beard.
That, man.
And it's 2019. I'm just gonna say you a CMF, all right?
What's that?
A corny motherfucker. That's all. It ain't no fucking way of getting around that.
You put
if
Beijing
you
in
put
your
Beijing in your fucking hair in 2019, use a CMF.
Well, we're gonna, our sponsor, EverythingDivaGlam.com, we're gonna start getting them caps, the wave caps.
Yeah, we gotta check it out.
Yo, what's the price point you want to think we could put on the wave caps? And you get the tight Jones one size fit, but you can just throw it on and it's like you got waves. And you might just want to do the town.
I'm going
to
keep it all the way real, though. If I get one of them joints, I'm get me curly hair. Like, because I never had curly hair.
You getting
like
a curly hair, Jones?
Yeah.
Is you going to wear do-rags then? A wave
Fuck
cap?
No. No.
No, because
I'm
going to
get my curly
hair,
shit to wear do-rags. Like, no. First of all, do-rags is not for niggas with curly hair. Like, that's just, first of all.
Who do-rags for?
Niggas with peasy hair. Like they come from Africa, motherfucker. It's for that. It's to lay that peasy shit down that's not trained. Motherfuckers that got good hair got trained hair. Your shit lay down. Like when do-rags is for niggas that look like it's a bunch of roaches fighting on your top of your shit.
You 37 Mac, don't he wear wave caps?
No.
You fucking lying. You mind me times I came in the crib and he walked up on me with a do-rag.
My son, no.
And disrespect
okay,
my,
okay,
he disrespect
okay,
my presence.
Okay,
I said,
hold on, what you doing with a do-rag?
You ain't even
hold
behind the door. He just walked around the crib and then he went outside with a do-rag.
Let me just say this. I cussed my son out
and
for wearing a do-rag.
And I said,
I said, dog.
Why you got a do-rag on?
Your shit lay down like a prayer rug.
I don't care if it lay down or not.
Why would you want waves and you already got silky smooth shit?
Only people that get away with wearing do-rags in public is OGs, old heads. I always respected them because I always wanted to. That's why I wanted to wear a wave cap when I was little, because old heads would be on the
but
corner.
But these niggas got some spicy wave caps going on. Red velvet pups.
Remember we saw the young boy with the he had a velvet red wave cap. Yeah, I'm like, yo, dog, you just wearing it in the public. That shit looked nasty.
It looked
you had that nasty ass wave cap.
That shit had lint all all stuck to it. From,
but it just looked nasty. Oh, like, you seen goodness. It from across the street, and it was shining. The sun was out. You got a nasty-ass red velvet wave cap on, and you're a young bull. Like, come on, man. Stop this old head shit. You might as well get you a 40 in a J. Like, straight up.
All right, let me just ask you a question. What are you listening to right now? What music?
I'm listening to... I listen to a bunch of stuff. You know my stuff is crazy. I'm, you know, I really tapped into, first of all, my man Sampa. I'm always listening to Sampa, the Process album. I'm listening to Saba. Who? Sampa.
Sampa?
Yeah, he's a singer from overseas. I'm listening to his album Process. I'm listening to Saba out of Chicago. He got a great album. Sirens is just my everything. I'm listening to a couple Baltimore artists now. Young Moose. Sosa, okay, Lord
shout
X,
out Young Moose,
Mick Savage,
East Side of Baltimore.
Yeah, I'm always listening to Philly artists. You got a lot of artists in Philly. You know what I mean? I really be like tuning into.
You know who one of my favorite Philly artists is right now?
Who?
Tierra Whack.
Yeah. She's legendary. She's just on it.
Rocky.
Go ahead.
Bree Steves.
Go ahead.
You know what's funny, though? In Philadelphia, I'm going to keep it all the way real. The women are kicking the niggas' ass right now.
Yeah, it's not that many women either. You got that's why.
And they are kicking the niggas in Philadelphia asses right now.
Not Sean Smith ass.
Sean Smith.
But what I'm saying is the women right now.
He's a different type of animal.
But let me tell you something. The women right now is holding it down in Philadelphia. On a different level right now.
I checked out this week. I had checked out. I've been checking out a couple people. Like, you know, Garcia got it. He got two nice joints. Joints just came out. Bugsy just dropped some stuff. You know, you got a Drama dropped some stuff. You got a Black Poppy just dropped the new joint. Like, it's a lot of people dropping. They just drop. It's a lot of these dudes, man. I just be listening. Once you know I what, see it, I go listen.
You know what my favorite album is right now?
What?
Lil Durk.
That's your guy.
Signed to the Streets 3.
That's your guy.
Absolutely.
He's a neighborhood hero.
Greatness.
That's, to me, right now, that's the hottest album on the streets.
You've been listening to that for a while, though.
Yeah, me too.
He really OD'd over that. He really OD'd.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, I'm an OG that like to keep up with what's going on. So when I had a road trip and I got in the car with my youngest, I said, so what y'all listening to? So, you know, they threw a bunch of albums on for me. And we was riding, and out of all the albums they threw on for me, the only one that really resonated with me was Lil Durk. I said, oh, this shit is hot. This shit hot. This is a different type of hot right here. Yeah, they played a bunch of niggas, and shout out to the baby. His shit was okay. His shit was all right. Shout out to Lil Baby. They two different niggas, right?
Come on, man. You ain't that. What type of plan is you?
Oh, all right, cool.
Nut?
Shout out to the baby.
That's why he's a nut.
Lil Baby. No, both day albums was hot, too, but that Lil Durk motherfucker was a goddamn.
Shout out to Kobe Southwest, too. He turning up out there, out in Southwest side of Philly. You know, Sim Santana turning up. You know, you got a lot of people, man. Like you said, Rocky. There's a lot of people in Philly that's really turning up, doing anything. It's just like, man.
And it's important that the OGs who time has came and prime has went, who has, you know, some type of prominent voice, who means something to the culture.
Salute them.
Salute the youngins.
Get them an alley hoop like the alley hoop you wanted when you was coming up. Like when you know, like I said, when we started the Figures, we ain't really had no, it wasn't no, I'm just running around like a madman giving out tapes. Dubbing tapes and.
But see, you know what's the reason why we never got no alley oops either?
Give it to
because
me.
Because even though we was trying to get on some rap shit, we had more money than the rappers that was on.
Yeah. That.
We was already flyer than niggas.
Yeah, you can say
we
that.
Was getting to a dollar. Like, we wasn't out here, like, we wasn't going to be busted and disgusted out here. As long as we was on the streets, we was going to get to some money. So, at the end of the day, you got rappers that we walking up on and
yeah, they was on.
We got Versace shit on.
Yeah, we was fly.
The niggas had on, I don't want to be shitting on no brands or nothing, so I ain't even going to say what niggas had on, but niggas wasn't having the shit we had on. We had on Moschino shit. Niggas was wearing, I was wearing Prada shit in the late 90s.
It was crazy. It was crazy.
So at the end of the day, when we walking up on motherfuckers, we already looking like we on, but we really trying to get a look from niggas. That's because we was taking money.
And you got to understand this. Major Figures started. I started Major Figures because, see, a lot of people always talking about collaboration. I want to collab with somebody. Collab. It's not always going to be that way. People's not just going to collab with you. So I wanted
because he wanted to collab with Ram Squad.
I wanted
back.
To collab with him because
I wasn't no rapper. So I didn't even give a fuck about none of that shit.
Because this is my man brother.
Right.
Tommy Hill was my man brother. So I'm like, damn, okay, we're going to connect. He's like, all right, baby, we're going to get together. And I said, ho, we rap better than this dude. All right, fuck all that. Gil, we starting our own group. And I went and started our own group. Come on, Major Figures is what we're going to do. Took Gil to the studio. They're talking about where we going. We going to the studio, you nut ass nigga. I ain't a rapper. You is a rapper. You's a nut. Like, you a rapper. Like, come on. We going to the studio. Took him to the studio. I got with the producer. He like, damn, I had everything lined up. We going out. Like, damn, we got to get a logo. We got to do this. I'm going downtown. Like I said, I'm taking all these tapes. We getting the tapes dubbed. And everybody that had a system or any type of car, a luxury car, foreign car, Acura, anything back, I would give them a tape.
But let me tell you something. The nigga low key tried to Suge Knight me.
I did not. I ain't get.
Yes,
no.
You did. Let me tell you what the nigga
Listen,
did.
Listen, at the time, I'm like 15. No.
Yeah, but at the time.
What I do?
He would dub all the tapes and go sell them. And give me, I ain't never seen a dime
no,
from
because
that
he, listen,
one.
Listen. I was a record company. I was Major Figure Records. Like, I had to listen. At the same time,
I ain't never seen a dime of that fucking tape.
And on everything I love, I got this nut and the producer, Dice Raw, we all in the studio. They never heard this. I play a Master P album. This 95. They like, yo, what the fuck is you playing? Like, I'm like, this that heat right there. The whole time I'm studying Master P because I'm looking at the Rap Pages magazine. And this back when they used to play him, he was with TRU and all. They had all that stuff. I'm looking at the Rap Pages magazine. I'm reading how he doing his independent rap thing. I'm like, damn, this is. So I'm like, I'm a Master P Gil. Not saying like that, but I'm like, I'm going to put him on. So I play Master P. They're like, damn, who do? You remember
all,
that?
First of all, you was Master Flea. Fuck is you talking about?
I'm not gonna tell you how many tapes I sold, either. You'll be mad.
I know, but you was a bootleg Master P.
And then
nigga.
I was stealing all the blank tapes. I was stealing 100 blank
flick.
Tapes, $5 a pop. It was crazy.
Okay, so let me ask you another question. Why is on social media, right? Why is the perception that people trying to have in the real world is, oh, I'm real, I'm doing this, I'm accomplishing this, I'm here, I'm there, I got all this big shit going on, but in actuality, everything's fake.
You know why? Because it's like we living in this world where it's though, when you come from poverty a lot of times, a lot of your moves is based off revenge. So your moves that you're putting up there to the world
mm-hmm.
on Instagram or whatever mm-hmm. is to really shit on somebody mm-hmm. that you're battling with, that you had this invisible battle with, or this revenge, or whatever's your ex, whatever's the people that you don't fuck with no more, or I don't mess with them no more, I'm going to shit on. Like, everybody movement
right.
and their whole energy is based off revenge. Like, I'm going to pay them back. I'm going to shit on them. Mm-hmm. I'm going to turn it up. So a lot of people put 20 on 5 to make it look like they really doing something when they really not, because it's not really about you thinking they trying to share their information with the world. A lot of times, it be about, I know they going to see it. I know they homie going to see it. I know they friend going to see it. Hey, friend, follow me. I'm shitting on them.
But, okay, so why is it that when we grow up in the atmospheres that we grow up in, why is that our mentality? When we get to a certain place in life, we not going to help other motherfuckers. Our whole purpose in life now is to shit on them. Oh, I'm about to go get the Bentley. I'm going to ride down on
everybody's
them niggas. I'm going to make them niggas sick when I pull up on them niggas.
Listen.
All them niggas. Oh, them niggas standing out there. They're all out there right now. I'm about to pull up on
listen.
These niggas. Watch these niggas' faces. I'm about to shit on them. Why is that the mentality?
That was, that's just us. Like, a lot of times, the way we look at each other is fucked up. And, like, that always been a thing from the street culture. The street culture always been this invisible competition, this battle of, y'all from 13th Street, we from 15th Street, we got them new Benzes, let's go shit on them dingers. Like, it always been like that. But now, it's on steroids where everything is based off of things. It's like this. Everybody is, like, wearing these masks because they covering up, you know, the things. They cover up your insecurities, your fears, and really how you feel about yourself. You know what I mean? Oh, let me wear these things. Let me wear this jewelry. Let me wear these clothes. Let me wear all this shit. It's the illusion and the perception of I won in life and you didn't.
Okay, so let me ask you a question. And you can chime in on this too, Dev. So were we insecure?
What?
Back in the day when, say, you know, you go to a club. You got other stick-up boys. You got other hustlers. You got other getting money niggas that's right over there. They popping bottles in. You like, how many bottles them niggas got? Oh, them niggas got 6 bottles. Yo, tell them niggas bring us out 8 bottles. Is that insecurity or is that just a competition thing?
That was a competition. But the only motherfucker that made me insecure back in the day was Happy Feet Mac. See, I hated him. Every time we went to dances, he wanted to be dancing all, like I got
oh,
all.
Oh, yeah, you couldn't fuck
no,
with
no,
him.
No, no, we got all these clothes
You talking
on.
About the nut-ass Indian boy?
Yeah, but listen, no, listen, yeah, I'm glad you named him right. But I'm saying this. We got all these designer clothes on, but all the chicks were him. So I'm standing there like, yo.
But I'm going to keep it all the way real,
he was
though.
He out there.
I'm
going to
keep it all
the
way real,
15
though.
Songs, his feet. I know his feet was stinking.
And I'm going to keep it all the way real,
too. He had
the
dreads and all. He do house party dance. He do the Jamaican joint. He do the hip-hop dance.
Because you know back in the day, they used to call him DM, way before the direct messages or any. He was DM, dance machine, right? So, but we would go to dances, right? Wallow was the type of nigga. You know, I'm 3 years older than Wallow.
I go right
in. He, you know, he was in the shit that I wasn't into. I wasn't the nigga that was going to be in the middle of the party. And
I go
know,
right in.
He go right in.
Slide right between two chicks.
He's sweating like motherfucking Harriet Tubman, goddamn trying to get out the Underground Railroad.
I'm talking about 15 songs straight. But right. This dude to go 35.
He the type of nigga, too. He the type of nigga, too, lead a club with blue balls, though. Yeah, I mean, he done danced with a bitch. You know what I mean? He hard.
Oh, no. But it didn't really matter. That's just the prep for when I get home. I'm curing up.
But listen, he hard in Russian Jeopardy.
Listen,
you know what
they just introduced me to a good time.
He done danced with a bitch for 42 songs straight. Digga, hard.
No. And I'll be sorry, listen.
And then he go home and jerk off.
No. Listen, you know what's my joke? You know what's my joke? Because I was a nut. I'd be dancing with a joint, especially when the slow joint. You know, they throw the slow joint, I slow drag with her. And then once it speed up, I always do this joint. Why you doing this to me?
Hey, no. But
stop
listen,
playing with me.
But listen, all though. That. He the type of nigga, though. He'll see some chicks dancing from all the way over across the other side of the room, right? You know, he'll do his whole 1-2 over there, but he acting like he just, you know, like he just dancing like
that was a whole move.
He all the way across to the other side of the floor, and then just wham right behind the chick, just out of nowhere.
My jaw.
And that's like, how you were supposed to do it back in the day.
No. Grab but you know what I mean? Bitches 13 down. He'll slide all the way through the joint, all the way through the dollar party. He'll slide all the way through the joint. But let me tell you something. His accept rejection game.
Was extraordinary.
Okay.
Oh, because he'd jump right on the ass. Bam, right on it. So damn tough, right? Cool. In the party. This would be like, no, I'm cool.
Why was so damn tough on?
But listen.
That was a classic. That was a party.
Nah.
No, that was the classic.
I'm saying, but niggas was listening to that. What year was this?
No, man? You always had the classic songs back in the day that would play.
That would play in the club. That was the dollar party joint.
We don't play.
Like, you got to understand.
So what year is this grinding going on? Probably. What you think?
I've been going on my whole life. That shit was early in the...
Yeah, that shit was... Dog, I was 11 years old going to dollar parties.
But he was a hater. Dollar party, I was a classic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But I always had running.
He was the nigga that used to sweat the most in every dollar party.
But you know you can't do that no more? Like, you can't just, like, slide up on a butt. Like, remember how back in the day you used to hit the club and just literally, like, walk up on the joint?
That shit Wallow used to do back in the day would be considered a rape right now.
No, I wasn't. You was raping bitches back then. Don't put smut on my name. This is what I'm saying.
LGBT nowadays, all types of niggas.
Nowadays, it can happen. Not saying the way I was, you know what I mean? But me, if I was still in the club scene, it'd be over.
Because back in the day, you could just walk up and just bite a joint ass.
No, first of all, he was blitzing bitches like it was fourth and inches, ball on the goal line back in the day.
I wasn't biting
nobody. I'm just saying, back in the day, you hit palmers. You used to hit the palmers up. You walk in there, it was all dark.
Hey, that's a perfect example. He was like them nut-ass niggas that used to be in palmers.
I'm saying, I seen this shit.
What?
I was sweating, dancing like a motherfucker.
Oh, yeah.
I never went to Palmer's.
No, you was locked up, man.
That's back when AI used to be out there, have his whip out there, all that. You know what I'm saying?
But no, see, we living in a time like, listen, I couldn't go to a club. You know why? Because it just programmed DM, and I'd be back dancing machine. Because you know why? I'm like, everybody that's in the club now, like all the dudes, they just standing on, and everybody cool. Everybody too cool to say anything to the chicks. So I'd have been in there from here, right now. if I was a club, if I was a party animal, if I was a party animal again, it'd be over. I'd be in every club all over the, everywhere.
I'm gonna keep it all the way real. He'd get us robbed now, and this.
How would I get y'all robbed? Cause because I want to dance.
These young niggas would be like, no, old head, they some nut ass niggas.
Look at this niggas. Nigga.
Look at old head. Look, old head ain't sat the fuck down all night. We robbing the shit out of old head. Listen, when he get out of
here. Let me just say this. What the fuck is we going to the club for, to stand around and no, just look just at people?
No, I'm just telling you how
that's
they,
what a lot of niggas
do. Listen, hold on, I see dudes all the time.
I'm just explaining to you the young niggas mentality now. So as soon as we come in there, you all in there, you all night. They like, damn, old head ain't sat down and chilled all night. You, every song, you like this. Like, motherfuckers don't slow dance no more. You want to slow dance with bitches like it's 88. Always and forever. This ain't 88. You getting us robbed.
No, I'm not.
As soon as they get outside.
This is going to happen.
We robbing old head.
What's going to happen is, I'm just going to add another gun retrieval to my jacket. Because if he come out there with that bullshit, I'm going to take the gun from him and beat his ass in the parking lot. Like, I'm not, like, you got to understand this, man. Like right now, it's to the point where it's though.
Hey, that shit sounded
good. I'm waiting to exercise my martial arts on somebody.
That shit sounded, I'm going to add another gun retrieval to my.
All it's going
to
be is.
All that's going to do is you're going to take them W's look, off fast as shit.
All it's going to be is. No. That's why I got two for that time when they come. So when the young boy come with the piece, this and that third. Hey, oh, wait, take that joint. Oh, young, we ain't got to go through all that, baby. These you. These you, baby.
So you going to ask him, can you keep one? Like, can we get matching necklaces?
Okay, I'm like, listen, man, I'm scared. I can't even. Can you just take it off, young boy? You know, they goofy. I got it. Put it good. These, they so goofy. I got it. All perked up. I got it. Oh, okay, oh, wait, I got it. You see, this type of shit I like. Soon as he go, he going to go right behind me. Whoop! Flip him. Lay him down. Kick him all in his head. Whoop! Take the gun. Just like the movies. Hit the gun 2 times. Whoop! The clip going to fly out. Whoop! Break it all down and throw it down there. Like, was it worth it? That's what the fuck I'm going to do. I ain't got time to be playing games with these boys.
So let me ask you a question. What's some of the fake shit that just annoy you?
Me personally?
Like on Instagram.
Like well, who?
Like this fake shit that on social media, period, that people do that just, okay, you know what some of the fake shit I hate? This is the number one shit that burns me up. And I spoke on this on a prior podcast. When these entertainers come to these niggas' cities and a nigga take a picture with these rappers, post it on Instagram and leave that bullshit caption.
That's not fake. That's the new real.
No, that's real shit. That shit burns me up.
Oh, you talking about when the boys say, yeah, we got big things going on?
No, when the nigga say shit like, Jeezy told me he's not the only snowman, I'm the new snowman. And the picture be with him and Jeezy like this. You know?
I actually like that.
I think God.
I think it's so funny to me.
Don't nothing bother me more.
I love that.
Than niggas fronting like that.
You don't find it entertaining though?
No,
it's entertaining to me because Instagram is Comedy Central to
me. But let me just say this.
I go in there and laugh all
day. Let me just say this. When you know in your motherfucking mind, body, and soul that Jeezy didn't tell a nigga that whole experience.
Lie to me. I love the lies.
That whole experience is nothing but a fraud. That shit just, that's mind blowing.
Like that is everything to me. I'm fascinated, and I think it's real funny when people just be on their line. But my thing that it pissed me off, you'll see, and it's both people, chick and dude. You'll see them take 1,000 trips, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm down Miami. I'm down here. I'm down. How you down Miami, you went down Miami 1,000 times and you rode past Orlando and you ain't never stopped and take your kids there. Like, I never seen your kids nowhere on no trips. You never take your kids nowhere, but you on 1,000 trips. You tripping. Oh, I'm a trip.
So you talk about these bitches who be in Bogota in Portugal and then they be in Dubai and then you look up and the bitch tripping. In Honolulu, bitch everywhere on Instagram, but the bitch got 4 kids. You never see her kids nowhere.
I just seen little Raheem down the way, little Boo Boo Raheem and a little black running down the street with some dirty sneaks on, messed up, wounded.
But they mama on Instagram in Honduras.
Yeah, like what the fuck? Like what's going on with you? You got the bags, the shoes, all that stuff. You on the gram? You always giving it to him. But every time I see little Boo Boo and them, Mr. Wilder, okay, I'm buying. Okay.
But where you want them to take the kids?
Let me tell Wilder this. Listen, I don't mind buying huggy hugs and juicy juices.
You know the problem with why you never see the kids, Wilder.
Why?
Because they're not tripping. They're tricking.
Yeah, where you want them? You want them to bring the kids along for the trip?
Well, you want the nigga to, of course, they selling that cable box.
What type of cable is it? What service?
It's premium.
No, but it's different type of cable boxes, huh? Like different type of cable companies. So, which one?
Some of them bitches selling Sexfinity. Fuck is you talking about?
Yeah, okay. That, okay. So that's lost. The problem.
So a
my
nigga
bad.
Flying them down, that nigga ain't flying they kids too.
Okay, my
nigga,
bad.
Like I'm flying you here, bitch. I'm flying you there. I'ma slap this dick off your face. I'ma fuck you. I'ma fuck on you all weekend.
Lil Raheem can't see this.
Lil Raheem can't bring this shit. I ain't got no babysitters out here.
Yep.
Keep them little niggas. Matter of fact, I'm about to cash app you a bean 50, 200. You pay your motherfucking somebody keep them little motherfuckers for 3 days.
Lunchables or whatever. Hold that nigga down.
Absolutely.
Some chicks will lead a nigga in the crib by himself. Nigga be 9 years old, going to school and everything.
Right.
Hand that nigga a key.
I don't believe that.
No, you out of your fucking mind, nigga.
You out your mind.
9 years old, leaving
these bitches leaving infants at home by themselves.
Show that nigga how to use the microwave.
They be like, mommy be back. Mommy going on the trip. Mommy be right back. Okay.
No, they not. They not doing it.
Absolutely.
I'm not going for it. So you saying these glorious and luxurious.
The ones that people look at like, our wife, she's so bad.
They not leaving Lil Boo Boo and Lil Kareem in the crib.
That nigga be in there on survivor mode, nigga.
Kareem be eating. Hey, guess what Kareem will be eating for 3 days?
Kareem a week.
Kareem a week.
And mommy be getting creamed, huh?
Word up.
Mommy somewhere getting baked in the damn and Kareem no, home crazy, but that's, Kareem that's, a week that, listen, for 3 days.
That, listen, that's the thing I hate, right? Listen, that's the thing I hate. And me, Raheem the Jeweler is my man. I seen his DMs. I seen Raheem the Jeweler DMs.
Yeah.
It was disgusting. Mm. When I seen Raheem the Jeweler DMs and the people that was in his DM and the people that's getting stuff from him, and when I see him on Instagram, I just be like, yo, this shit. Yo, I thought, listen, I knew Raheem the Jeweler was making moves, but his shit blew up. He's just on a whole nother level. Like the people that I see in his DMs, that people looking at rappers and eight, I'm like, athletes, I'm
and
like,
Raheem
damn.
The Jeweler is the jeweler that sells fake jewelry.
So, I'm
so
like,
Raheem knows who he is. Let me ask you a question. Who would you be? And listen, you got to answer this.
Oh, here you go with some crazy shit.
You got to answer this.
Come on,
there's
man.
There's no getting around it.
Come on, man.
You could be three. You could pick one of three males to be. Either you a male who your mom is on crack. Either you a male who your wife is on wet. Or you a male who your daughter is addicted to Percocets.
Y'all answer that shit. I'm not.
I mean, my mom was on crack, so I'd be me.
So you'll just be.
I turned out fine.
Okay. I never knew Mom Dukes was on the bottom.
I mean, listen, man, it was the 80s, man. It was a wild time. You feel what I'm saying?
I never knew Mom Dukes was on the bottom. I never knew you had that type of background.
Yeah.
A lot of
people do.
You never know what people go through. Yeah. I never knew Mom Dukes was on the butter to make the fiend stutter. Good, yo, give me another.
Listen, a lot of my second, third, fourth, a lot of my street moms, they had.
What?
Your street mom is like
the fuck are you? Your street mom.
Your street mom is like one of your homie moms. I was running the streets. You know, you got a bunch of different
sense.
Moms.
Street mom.
So my street moms, I had like 5, 6 of them. A lot of them, you know, a lot of times that shit happened in the '80s. They was introduced to her by a boyfriend or something. So it happened. So I had, you know, I was in a situation where a few of them, they got addicted to drugs and was, you know, had a moment, but they got themselves back together. But mm-hmm. I would say me personally, I'm not picking up three of them.
You got to pick one.
No, because listen, all right, now listen. If I pick one and say, oh yeah, my mom, you could do, she's going to, how you going to say I am? If I say my woman.
So wait, so if you pick your mom, what?
She going to be snapping. How you just going to say you going to have me on rocks? How you going to have me on? No, baby, it ain't even like that. If I pick my woman, oh, you just going to have me. You just going to have me wet it out. Now, and if I say, oh, yeah, my daughter on purpose. So you'll have our future baby.
What type of dad is you?
What type of nigga is you? So what I'm going to just say is, I'd rather be the one. I just put me on smoking wet.
But that's not an option, though.
That's not an option.
It's an option for me.
No, it's not.
I'm not even.
So what you're saying is you're not man enough to pick one.
Wow.
Because you weren't about what your mom's going to say. You weren't about what your woman's going to say. And you weren't about what your unborn kid is going to think. Put it on my unborn kid. Fuck it, my kid.
It's like, imagine.
They ain't here yet.
No, she'll be like, you got to pick. She'll be like, you just going to say our baby could be on perks? Our baby. So I'm gonna be the one smoking a wet. I smoke butt naked.
Listen, man.
If you smoke it wet, you know when you smoke wet, you get naked. You run around naked.
It don't matter. We were strippers before. So what?
Yeah, but it's different because you be like on the corner, like fingering your own butthole or some shit.
No, Dad.
Word up. Yo, niggas be out, bro.
Nobody never done that, Dad.
Yes, they have. They've never done it. Hold on.
So you said, so you just said Wallo 267.
No, don't say that. Listen,
it's going to smoke wet.
What I'm saying is,
stop that. Stop that.
First, Camden got one of the worst wet
ass. Nobody never done that.
Wait. Hold on. Hold the phone. Wait. Dev, hold on, Dev.
Nobody never done that, Dev.
Let's get this right, Dev. Let's get this right.
Don't put no smut on my name.
No, let's get
this right. Clean it out. That's crazy.
Okay, hold on. So you saying it's a chance that Wallo 267.
No, stop, Gil.
Could smoke wet.
He would
stick fingers in his jelly crimpets.
He would smoke wet, put a fucking tiger claw, the two fingers in his ass, and be out there throwing spin kicks and everything, fingers in his ass, man.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Because I'm trying to tell you, the wet shit make people chop baby heads off. Bro, you not smoking a wet in the wife.
Let's get this. So it's a possibility that Wallo could smoke wet and stick fingers in his ass.
Yo, come on, Gil.
Stick his own fingers in his ass.
Yeah, wet 0267, nigga. That be you, nigga.
Wet 0267.
Yo, it'd be a rap, nigga.
Well, listen.
Imagine your motivational videos, nigga, you'll jump off a fucking skyscraper, nigga. Land on your motherfucking feet.
How about this?
Yo, it's Wallo.
How about this? I'd rather be the old head coming around the corner. Young boy, what's up, young boy? You got any R&Bs? What's some old head? Rocks in the bag. Put me on crack then. Put me on crack.
Yo, you know why? You want to know why he wanted to smoke wet instead? Because of that motherfucking dream you had when they were smoking that wet with the ice, with the fucking ICF,
man. No, they were smoking reefer. They were smoking J's.
Said it was turbo, nigga. You said it was three different joints mixed all in there when you had the dream about Karate Earl and James Brown. Yeah, that's why you said you want smoke wet.
I'd rather be the old head, get the fuck off the corner. I'd rather be on rocks, hot rocks.
I think the worst one is your wife being on wet.
That's for you. I'm not
that's
picking
the worst.
So you mean to tell me you're not man enough to pick one?
It ain't about being man enough. I'm just saying, it's just like, how do you pick one?
Which one you picking, Gil?
Without hurting nobody's feelings, and they be mad at you.
My mom on crack.
What?
My wife on
I
wet.
I know you're not picking that.
You didn't say that.
My mom on crack, my wife on wet, or my daughter on perks.
He can't say he's going to put her on the Yerkes. There's no way she's going to be on the perk.
I'm going to keep it real. I would just have to help. I just had to help to get off the wet. Like,
oh, my God.
Like, I just had to, like, because I can't put my mom on crack and I can't put my daughter on perks. Like, but me and two to get through it. I get two'd off the wet. Like,
Toot on wet is crazy.
Because Toot be chilling. She'd be crazy.
Oh, my goodness.
She'd be chilling.
On wet would
she'd
be
go
different.
Crazy, man. What? The way she'd be washing the dishes.
For real, I wiggle Toot off the wet. Like, because, like, my mom, my sister, like.
Because Toot already be washing dishes
my
fast.
My daughter, like, how I'm going to put my mom on crack.
I ain't going to front. One time I thought Tootie was on speed. Because the way she be washing the dishes in the crib.
Yeah, she do be. But yeah, I would have to say I'll get Toot off the wet.
I'm like, yo, man, wet crazy.
I'll get Toot off the wiggles.
That's crazy.
You know, let's go to $1 million worth of game segment.
$1 million worth of game segment.
Okay. So I get a DM. And this girl says, Gilly, I got a question. My mother-in-law house be so filthy. Like shit stacked up everywhere, dust and roaches running around. When she cooks, she wants me to eat, but I be like, hell no. So when she turn her back, I throw the food in the trash. I'm wanting to just clean up her apartment, but I'm scared she gonna get mad. What you think I should do, OG?
I'm gonna just say this. Is that a man or a woman?
I think that's a woman.
You ungrateful motherfucker. You ungrateful.
What you mean?
What?
The roach is just part of the family. Like, I don't understand. Like, these people that's growing up now, they don't appreciate shit. You know, listen, when I grew up, Like, they were just a part of the family. Like, you see a Roach, this and that third. Raheem, what's up, baby? What you had a little wild night, huh? Because they'd be coming staggering out like, damn, they must have ran into a bad batch of something. Some old food or something.
Yeah, but you know what I used to notice, though? When, back in the G, when we used to come to Nanny House. Mm-hmm. You know, Wallow stayed in the basement.
I was a basement warrior.
He was a basement
warrior. No, wasn't. I wasn't one
you
yet.
You was a BMW.
No, because of my age. My age didn't qualify me. You got to get a certain age.
Yeah.
Remember, I was young.
Yeah. You're right.
Well, what's
you're
the age right. again? What's the age? Were you
25.
20? No. Yeah. 21. No, 20, you're a basement warrior. You're done. Because you're supposed to be out the career about 20.
No, not everybody out the career about 20. Because some people still in college and stuff.
All right. Well, not 25. That's too late. Right,
25 20. Made sense, though, because that's like graduating college.
Right. 25, basement warrior.
So a lot
basement
of warrior. Basement I be calling warrior. These young boys basement warriors, man. It's 21,
there's
man.
A lot of BMWs out
messing my jaw up, man.
There's a lot of BMWs out
well,
here.
Well, I was in the basement warrior, but I wouldn't say I would. I would never have been a basement warrior.
You was in basic training. Basement training.
Warrior training. All right, baby.
Basement training. Yeah, basement there, training. There we go. Yeah. But I would come in Nanny House, and one thing I always noticed is anytime you was upstairs, you never seen no roaches. But you go to Wild Old Room in the basement, and it was like roaches going wild, like down that bitch. It was like
once Nanny like, and them told me,
it was like you was a, it's nah, like you, I'm a it's like you a roach
put
magnet.
You, put man. You in the secret that you don't remember.
It's like you attract listen, roaches. Like.
He gonna remember this. You remember the candy jars? He gonna tell you. I had a candy jar, right? The plastic candy jar that I took from the store around the corner, right? And that's the jar. You used to be like, yo, why don't roaches in that jar?
Yeah,
because I used to put food in there and feed them. I couldn't have a dog, so roaches was my pet.
So you was like the DMX of roaches, like how DMX only had dogs?
Yeah, I used to, listen, the roaches on some real stuff. I used to see them as like, you know how people see, what's some Jones that glow in the dark and they put them in the jar?
Lightning bugs?
Lightning bugs and little all type of stuff. They can, and I used to just let them do the little thing.
I never understood how he could pick a roach up.
You for real?
Dog, that nigga used to pick roaches up.
Like, I don't understand.
Like, he was one of them nasty young boys picking roaches up. What are you talking about? It's only a roach crawling in his hand and shit.
Because it was cockroaches, man. It was a little.
No, he used to pick regular roaches up too. Baby roaches, all kinds of
listen,
shit.
You had to listen. And then when you see the shells and they be shedding, all, you put it, listen, but I had this little joint, right?
Yo, bro, look.
And they used to just come in there. I throw their little food and throw their little snacks in there.
This
and they
nigga
would come
had roaches
in there.
For listen, pets.
Because I showed him one day. He was like, what are you doing? I'm like, watch this. Like, they was out, you know, doing, you know, because one thing about roaches, they just like us. They daytime, they go out, they do their work, they go traveling. So I put the food in there, right, inside the joint. I used to put a little stuff in there. And here I'll be like, watch this, cuz. I'll be like, look, watch. And they all come. They start coming to the spot.
He ain't lying, but listen, though. Tell them about your homemade mousetrap.
No, I ain't telling them
with
all
the bleach.
I tell them all that.
What?
It's too deep. It's too deep. I do mouse traps. Listen, this is what I do. See, now the mice is a different thing. See, what I do is I'm a bleach warrior. I catch mice with bleach. See, if you go to the cracks in the walls, a lot of the holes, like, you know how some people use the Brillo pad type joints where you put it inside of the hole and that's when the mice hit it and poke them up?
Yeah, yeah.
Nah. What I do is I firebomb their house. Listen, this is what I do. I take bleach, and don't you know the what's names? I love them. Either a spray bottle or... You know the Jones, because they're my best weapon of choice. You got the mustard and ketchup squeeze bottles. You know the ones you get for like picnics, and they got the little Jones tin. I put it in there, right? And I go to all the mouse holes, and I spray their hole down. That annihilate them. They hate bleach. Like, I really could have been.
But how did you find that out as a kid?
No, because Nanny. This is what Nanny did.
So hold on. Your Jones just was stinking like dead mouse bodies down there?
No. It wasn't stinking like that. They would run. Once they smelled it, they'd go to the next house. Because, you know, you live in them houses, room. You know?
Yeah.
So, but Nanny showed me a lot of stuff. Because Nanny, this is what Nanny did. This was why Nanny was legendary. Nanny used to take the mice, when she catch it on the trap, go to the back door of the kitchen and burn it. I was like, Nanny, why are you burning the mice? So his friends would smell it. That was legendary. She's like, no, this little buddy's going to smell them, and they're going to know that. She told me that shit. I said, damn, she's a legend. Because Nanny wasn't scared of mice and shit. You know what I mean? I said, she's a legend.
Hey, let's go to stories from the cell.
Now, stories from the cell. This is a special shout out to everybody out there in the street operators doing your thing. The guys is too cool for a job.
Yeah.
I'm not working. I ain't no fucking sucker. I ain't going to no 9 to 5.
I know a bunch of them.
Listen, well, I was them too. I never worked until I went to jail. My first employer was the Department of Corrections of Pennsylvania. So this is
stories from a cell.
Stories. Now, I'm up Dallas, cell. Right? I get up there, right? You know, you just want a job, right? Kitchen job. You always get that stuff. UG2, UG3. That's utility. It could be a different job. You could be doing stuff on the ground. You could be doing all type of stuff. Underground, cleaning grease traps, whatever. So it was this guy named Mr. DeGallis. He was the inmate employer for the jail. I must have wrote this dude 30 request slips. A request slip is a slip that you write to any staff member looking for. And he used to send me the jobs. And I used to see this dude in the hall. Every time I seen this dude anywhere, because he used to be a CO, but he wound up turning into the employee. Anybody that was up Dallas back in the day, night, they know who DeGallis was. He was the job coordinator. Mm-hmm. So I used to chase this boy there. Anytime he come on the block, they see he might come on the block, talk to some girl. Hey, DeGallis, let me, how you doing? Hey, man, what's going on? Mm-hmm. Hey, what's up, man? Yeah, man, what's going on? And what opened up? I'm trying to get certain jobs. Like, damn, did that open up? Because they was good paying jobs. Right. You know, and I say good paying, I'm telling them, like, you'll go from 19 cents to like 30 cents or 20 cents. Like, you'll get a big pay raise, right? Quick, you know, talking about an hour. That's back when they was giving you like 8 hours a day. Now they only give you like 6. But it was just about, because, if you don't have a job, you'd be on like idle pay. Idle pay was like 17 cents, some shit like mm-hmm. that, a couple hours. So I'm like, damn. So one day, I ran up on him. Every time he came on our block, I ran up on him. Hey, excuse me, Mr. DeGallis, can I talk to you for a minute? Yeah, you know, I was looking at the job. I got a list. Did any of these open? I'm having real politically correct talk with him. Like,
right.
That was like my, you know, I had my quote-unquote, you know, your employment talk, where you go, your interview talk. Hey, how you doing today? Yeah, it was a great day, man. You see the game? Okay, yeah, man. Listen, I got the list. I'm still be going over the list. Is anything, any of these open up? Mm-hmm. Different special jobs? Is that third? So my old head caught me one day. He seen me doing the joint. He called me. He said, young boy, come here, young. Come here, man. Why the fuck you always running up on DeGallis when he come on the block? I said, oh, I'm trying to get a gig. A gig? You don't do that. Why the fuck you ain't have a gig on the street? Your stupid ass wouldn't be here.
Right.
I said, no, ain't nobody working on the street. That's the fucking problem. Why you want to work in jail now, huh? Now you are, every time I see you, he barbecued me. Every time I see you, mosey your little tap dancing ass over there to talk to the man about a job.
Right, but you was too cool to get a job on the street.
You was too cool on the street. He said, all that shit. He said, I don't work for these motherfuckers. I said, but over here, you doing like 1,000 years. So the fuck what?
Right.
I ain't getting no motherfucking job on the street. I ain't getting no job now.
So over here basically told you was a sucker ass nigga.
Yeah, you young motherfuckers. That's what I'm saying, man. You young motherfuckers be out there doing all this shit. Now you come here, y'all kills me with that shit.
Now you bitching.
Listen, he said, get the
now
fuck.
You come here, you want to work.
Huh? Listen, he said, get the fuck away from my door, man. Shit sad. Look at you, man. Fuck away from my door. I got the fuck away from his door. I mean, he was so.
His old head would have fucked you up.
No, he
picked you up, dumped you on your head, knocked all the seeds out your watermelon.
No, he was an OG. See, it was a different time.
I'd have got that call. They fuck Wallow up.
No, no, I was no. He was old head. So I started respecting. I understand because it was different. It was a different time. See, now and then.
Your old head dumped Wallow all on his head.
That wouldn't have happened because I respected him, and it wasn't about emotion. It was about real.
You better have respected him.
I mean, no. I'm just saying it was a different time now. If you check a young boy, he want to kill you. If you check a young boy, or you try to give him game through a check, they don't want to hear it. You tell him what to do. But as my old head, I had to listen to it because he ain't say nothing wrong. Right. I'm tap dancing over there to get a job from the quote-unquote man, but I ain't want to work out here. When your grandma or your mom, your boy, could you go get a job? I ain't fucking working for nobody.
Right.
But I'm over there.
So you was too cool.
Sammy, Mammy, can I get a job? Hey, I need a job. All this dumb shit. Because now you hit the penitentiary, ain't nobody really doing nothing for you like that. And you gotta, you know what I mean? And you can't, like, if somebody sends you some money, you can't keep doubling up on them. Yo, I need another check. I need another money. Motherfuckers got real lives out here. People is right. Out here taking care of their families. Right. That's why I tell dudes right now, don't go to jail.
Cost too much to be a criminal.
Cost too much to be a criminal, baby. Don't wait until it's too late to figure out you don't want this. Because I had to. But that was a power of checking. That's stories from a cell, man. It's real.
And I understand that. Old head checked him, man. Understand this in life. You're never too young. You're never too old to be checking. Checking is just a form of correcting. That's it. So you're never too young. You're never too old to be checked.
Yeah.
I'm going to say this again. Checking is just a form of correcting.
That's why I check in that ass every day for being a nut ass nigga.
If you got somebody around you that you can't check when they wrong because I guess they're uncheckable, or the person that they are on the inside doesn't allow them to be checked, then they're a nut ass nigga. Get around some other motherfuckers. Let's go to, I got a deep question. if you guys were an artist in the music industry, would you sign a 360 deal?
You fucking right. No, can I break it down?
God damn, you just signed your life away tomorrow.
No, no, I'm not saying it.
He ain't even see the paperwork or nothing. No, where's it at?
No, I'm just saying, he said if I was an artist, and I'm a younger guy, right?
Right.
The only reason I'm saying that for me personally, I'm thinking like this. If I'm an artist, I'm a young cat, I'm living in the hood, motherfuckers dying every day, B.
Right.
So it's like, I need to get with these people because a deal really is about connecting with their Rolodex and their relationships. So I could get on this bus, get on these tours, get some paper to get live in a better environment. So I had to go through this shit and I could be able to earn for me and my family. I understand they're going to be taking a nice portion out of my shows, my merch, my this, my that, my fucking move, all that stuff. But it's like, what's the shot that I might get a chance? You know what I mean? Listen, you know how many young boys had a chance to get a deal and they ain't get no deal and they still in the fucking ghetto?
Exactly.
And their life is on the line every day. So my whole thing is like, this is the only way, only reason I'm saying it. That's if I don't have a proper team around me where as though we could do it independently. Correct. To where I can afford a better deal. Because a lot of people, all right, you might be buzzing in your neighborhood. You might be buzzing in your town, but that don't mean you're supposed to get a deal outside of 360, because what have you done by yourself? Right,
so I know a lot of people that'll have incredible music, you know what I'm saying? But they don't have a team, like you said.
Yeah.
And they'll be like, I ain't taking no fucking 360. Mm-hmm. In their mind, they still think that the record business is this magical day that you go up there, you play your song, they bring out a gold fucking pen, sign your contract, your fucking money rains on your head, and you get such amount of money because they hear all this shit. Like, so-and-so got 1.5 for his deals. Like, no, nigga, first off, they didn't get $1.5 million put in a bank account.
No.
That shows the ignorance that they don't know nothing about this business.
Right.
That's a possible amount of budget that they might be spending on that project.
Right.
Niggas don't be
and
getting.
And out of that 1.5, he might have gotten $200,000.
And then look, they'd be charging the joint up crazy. And you'd be like, what? When did I blow through the budget? Like, you'll look up and they'll be like, yeah, you only got $200,000 left. On what, nigga?
Right.
That flight was not that much. That studio time is not that much. Like, them hotel rooms was not that much. The meals.
Atlanta.
You trying to say Beverly I ate $10,000 of food in the last 2 months? No, I didn't. You know what I'm saying? So the 360 deal, in the 360 deal, because some people probably don't even understand. In the 360 deal, they basically own you. You know what I'm saying? So they making money off of anything you do. Like, you might go be in a movie, be in a commercial, whatever you do. Because basically they have an ownership of your likeness, which is your face.
All right, now what about this? You said they own you. Do you rather them own you, or like, I'm just talking about from a young boy that's in the streets, or the graveyard of the penitentiary owning you? Because at the end of the day, it's like, I'm not promoting nobody going sign 360. I'm talking about me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not promoting nobody. If you got the traction to be able to have your own LLC, got your publishing right, and you moving, you able to live off your merch and tour and do it, cool. But a lot of people don't have no other option because they didn't do nothing extraordinary. Back in the day when Master P and Cash Money did, they already did numbers before they even went to the label. They had a proof of concept.
Well, see, that's why it's even more reason why today you shouldn't do a 360, because okay, back in the day I could walk up on Puff and spit some hot shit and Puff is like, sign that nigga,
right?
I didn't prove nothing. Now record labels don't sign you unless you already put the work in, unless,
some type of work,
unless you already build your brand up, unless you've already got a lot of traction going on behind what you do. See, back in the day, I feel like back in the day is when they should have been signing 360 deals, because artists got signed who didn't put no work in.
Some people still didn't put work in. They got lucky.
You feel what I'm saying?
No. But some people still didn't put work in. They got lucky. See, a dude could go in here and record something, right? Not necessarily the work, but maybe the song, just whatever happened, whoever reposted it, it catches fire. That dude still don't got no team. He don't have no idea how to move, how to tour, how to do appearances, nothing. But he already buzzing. So he needs an infrastructure to kind of be organized. You know what I'm saying? And he might miss his chance.
But due to lack of infrastructure,
you can miss your shot.
But infrastructure and you signing the 360 deal was two different things.
Well, it depends on how long is this deal? Because it's not a lifelong.
Okay, but hold on. At the end of the day.
It's like it. It's your lifelong in your career.
At the end of the day, it's all about knowing your worth. That's what it's about. Okay, prime example. You got a kid like Uzi, right? Who is mad at DJ Drama and them.
I think that's over with Gil. I think that's
But not. What I'm saying, he was. I'm giving prime examples.
Okay.
Right? I guess he felt as though he not making the money he's supposed to make.
But.
Right? But the flip side of that is you got 9 cars.
That's what we saying.
But at the end of the day, now he knows his worth. See, back then, when he was first signing, he didn't know his worth. Now you look up and you like, I done made the record company.
Yeah, I don't know his particular situation, but maybe that still wouldn't have happened without aid. You know what I'm saying?
I'm not just saying, per se, Lil Uzi. Right. I'm saying this where the problem come in with artists. They be wanting to get on so bad in the beginning. But then when they get on and they start understanding how the music business go, you look up and you like, I done made these niggas $130 million.
But what the thing is, when they do that sometimes, now it's all going to depend on the people. Did you make them that money or did y'all make that money? Because were you going to be able to do that without them or was you going to be at Nanny House?
Okay. Yep. Let me ask you a question.
I was at Nanny House.
Let me ask you a question. When LeBron James fill them seats up, did he fill the seats up or did we fill the seats up? No, all LeBron James. So hold on, wait.
He still needed to answer.
I'm gonna answer.
Let me finish.
Mm-hmm.
LeBron James filled them seats up. So when you're talking about an artist, is it did you do it or did we do
I
it?
Can answer
wait,
that.
Wait. Can I finish? Wait, no. I did it. You know why? Because you got 200 other fucking artists on this record label. They didn't do it. You couldn't do it with them. Well, hold on. You couldn't do it with them. Because let's be for real. How many artists do Def Jam got signed to them that we never fucking hear about? They never come out. They just tax write-offs. So don't give me no motherfucking shit. Oh, we... No. It was my music that moved the motherfucking needle. It wasn't y'all. It was my fucking music because y'all put out Ronnie this year. Y'all put out Bobby this year. Y'all put out Ricky and y'all put out Mike. And ain't none of them niggas did shit because their music don't move the needle.
Now, so I think it's like this. Comparing an athlete, if I could punch you in the face and knock you out, I could knock you out. Can't nobody have an opinion about that. If I could shoot every shot like Steph Curry, can't nobody have an opinion about that. Music is an opinion and most people on the radio are programmed. If the record label puts the money into it and puts you on the radio and that song comes on all day, it's going to gravitate a fan base. So you could force a musician on somebody, you will never be able to put me on a basketball court, put $1 billion into me and make me the star of a team.
Because we get 1,000 niggas who they put a gang of money into at radio. Then the album come out and they do 21,000 the first week.
I mean, I don't know so if those artists, like right day, now in this time period.
Who
blew a budget crazy and the song didn't work right lately?
Hold on. The majority of the artists today blow the fucking bag and the song don't work.
No, I'm talking about on the radio?
Yeah, the majority of the artists blow the bag. Let's be
He's
for real.
He's talking about Hold the on. People that really go.
Hold on. Let's be for
he
real.
He said a lot of people don't really go, Dev.
Let's be
a lot
for
of
real.
People probably just let's like...
Like, I know there's Hold a bunch on. Of artists let's sitting on a
real.
Label.
Let's be for real. The radio don't mean shit.
Not totally. That's
this
not
is,
true.
This I'm is, not going to agree with you. That's totally, totally
this
true.
Is,
you
this
saying totally?
2019. We are not in 19 fucking 97.
It's two different audiences.
Okay, let me ask you a question. When's the last time you got in the car and listened to the radio?
Every time I'm I'm in the car with my girl, all of them listen to the radio. They all know. They all go to them radio concerts, all that powerhouse. All they listen to.
I'm not saying the radio doesn't mean nothing.
SoundCloud. They listen to YouTube.
Right.
They listen to iTunes.
They Spotify. Listen to XM radio. Sirius satellite radio.
He talking about like local radio. I understand what you're saying.
The local radio that's getting the bag to play the.
Right.
So at the end of the day, it's like, let's be for real. Hold on. Back in the day, artists got on because you got your song to the radio. Your song came on the radio. Oh, you're excited. You're going crazy. Everybody around you that's going crazy because your song's on the radio. Now your song hit the radio. Motherfuckers that hang with you wouldn't even know because they don't listen to the radio. So it's like, you had to, oh damn, my song, your song was on the radio last night? Damn, I didn't even know. I didn't even, because the radio is not as important as it was. Think about the song
back in the day. Back in the day. Video killed the radio star. You remember that?
I do remember.
Back in the day, they was talking about how video killed the radio. You remember, I'm talking
about. No, I know exactly what you're talking about.
This was ancient times. So what he's saying is the internet killed everything.
It wouldn't matter if it was the internet or where it was. If the label puts a budget into something, right? Yeah, most of the people
talking about the budget.
Yeah, but most labels put budgets into all of the artists.
No, they don't.
Hold on, bro. Wait.
He talking about big budgets.
Wait. Hold on, bro. It's a label is not even acting on an artist if they don't put a budget to the side.
You talking about from some the side to sign it when you get signed as a budget.
Some type of...
When you get signed as a budget.
So at the end of the day, the difference between them niggas going and them niggas not going is the music. You could put $1 million behind one song. If the people don't gravitate to the song, it doesn't matter.
How much money?
But he just answered something. So if the song, right, is hot, but it still needed the $1 million for people to hear it, and then they know it's hot, then they both did it.
No. Okay, hold on. Definitely they both did it, but this is me. I got to take the. Okay, let me ask you a question. When the album of the year come out, who the fuck get called up there on stage?
But don't they?
What, when they win the album of the year?
I mean, obviously.
The writers, don't
okay,
the writers
okay,
get called
Okay, hold on,
nah,
hold on.
Obviously, they call the artist
okay,
up
okay.
there.
When they call the MVP of the league, who do they call?
But nobody do it by themselves, Gil.
Nobody, but at the end of the day, I got to have the exceptional talent to take this shit to the next level. Because at the end of the day, okay, hold on. Universal, okay, let's use the basketball team. Mm-hmm. Y'all got X, Y, Z, W, P, A, B, C. Y'all got all these niggas on the team.
Why they can't have 2-6-7?
Hold on. Y'all niggas ain't been going to the playoffs. Y'all already got all these niggas. Y'all niggas ain't been going to the playoffs. Then when y'all niggas got me, y'all niggas went to the playoffs. So you cannot say that, well, it ain't you. No, nigga.
You talking about sports again.
It's me. That's the same as the record business. Y'all got all of these niggas signed to the label. None of these niggas want platinum. But now you want to say, oh, you did the same. You gave all these niggas budgets too. You gave all these niggas a shot too. You put that nigga's record out. The highest it won on the charts was 87. You put that nigga's record out. The highest it won on the charts was 43. You put that nigga's record out. The highest it won on the charts was 45.
Hold on.
Let me finish explaining. Because let's be for real. This is what all the record labels do. They put it out. They put some money behind it. They want to see what it does. They get feedback. They call all the radio stations in all the areas. How's the record doing? Oh, they like this record here. Oh, how's the record doing in St. Louis? Oh, yeah, they calling in for this record. How's the record doing in Philadelphia? Oh, yeah, they calling the record in. How's the record doing? Okay, cool. They like the record. That's what all the record labels, that's what all the radio stations are saying. Okay, let's put a little bit more money into it. Okay, here you go. Oh, wait, it is picking up. It went from 98 on the charts to now it's 51 on the charts. Okay, we see that people like this. Let's put some more money into it. Okay, now we got the record in the top 10. Oh, shit. It's really picking up. It's playing on 45 radio stations across the country. Let's put some more money into
and
it.
And they're feeding it the whole time.
Okay, because the music people like
but
the
it's still
music.
Only reason, it was still both.
So you reason, got to reason, have the product.
This is the only reason I'm going to agree with
you. You could be a drug dealer. You could be a drug dealer. Dislike a drug dealer. You got all the product. But this shit ain't A1 Padico. So it's not moving.
Ain't that somebody's name, Padico?
It's not A1. Like, it's not that. It's not listen, that shit that had the fiends like this. He got the shit that the fiends want to hear.
But now, even he with, got even the, with shit, the shit the fiends need, you need the trucks, the
no,
movement.
No, but hold, hold. Let me just say this. Let right. me just say this.
But at the end I'm of the day, this. If you don't got the good work, none of it don't matter.
But so back to you the, so back to the beginning, when the dude is sitting have, there, he what is he regretting that? I regret that y'all, that I needed y'all vehicle to get my good product to
this.
The world.
But let me say this. Let me say this.
Okay.
Okay, cool. I'm going to end this with this.
No, we ain't gonna end this because I got something to say.
No. I'm agree with you. I don't like agreeing with you because you're a nut ass nigga. But this time I can. Dev is saying you need this budget.
What I'm saying is a person acting like they did it by themselves, like they regret that the record label put them in that position. Like, okay, bro, you hot. But what, how was you going to do that by yourself? It's easier to look in retrospect.
Nobody could do it by themselves.
Nobody. He told me.
Michael Jordan is the greatest, but he had a team. But at the end of the day, Michael Jordan is the nigga that led the team. It was his greatness. Like, so at the end of the day, if you ask any of them other players on the fucking team,
right.
How did y'all win a championship? All of them's going to say the same
thing. So what was Michael supposed to do without the Bulls?
Jordan.
No, but this is what I'm saying. This is what I'm saying. He said that he had a team. Now listen. Listen to this, guys. Both of you. You saying you need a budget. Gil saying it's about the talent. You saying, do y'all both agree that you need a team?
Yes.
I agree that
but
you
need
both.
But at the end of the day, let's keep it real. I know motherfuckers who blew up without a budget.
Do talent supersede budget?
Hold on. Let me ask you this question. I know motherfuckers that blew up without a budget. Prime example, Meek Mills didn't have a fucking dime behind him what was popping all over the country without one fucking coin behind him. I'm talking about the nigga who had the braids going to the back, none of the flashy cars, none of the watches, none of the diamond necklaces. None of that.
You always go back to me. But I'm going to say this
though.
Hold on.
So I done seen plenty of niggas blow up without a budget, right? How many niggas have you seen a budget blow up and them niggas ain't got talent?
Man, we could talk about that all day, but dog, there's plenty of people that rap that don't got talent, man. There's a million people with amazing musical talent that are never going to get hurt because they don't have no budget or way to get to the world. They're in the internet, they're a lost thing, come on bro, you don't come across talented artists.
Hold on, you gotta understand this too. Just because a person got talent, it doesn't mean that they're ready to be a star.
I mean, that's true. That's
I know
true
a
too.
Lot of motherfuckers that got talent, but it's like, oh, they're extremely talented, but they that's don't have too. Star quality.
That's true too.
Okay, hold on. He's not as talented as him, but he's a star.
All right, so
he has that glow about
this,
him.
This is what I'm trying to
he
figure
has
out.
That,
Hold on.
I'm trying to really figure this out so I can understand what Gil's bringing this home. So when the artist like a Uzi Vert or somebody gets into that position and they look down and they like, damn, man, I got 9 cars. I got all of this stuff. I feel like I got robbed of some sort, right?
Uh-huh.
What would be the almost like, I'd rather give this all up, start back at the beginning, and I would do this without DJ. We're using them as an example. DJ Drama, I don't want his help. I don't want these people. I'm going to do it the way I was going to do it from the muscle or whatever.
But see, there's a difference with Uzi because Uzi didn't have the streets. Uzi didn't have... Whereas though, I'm already buzzing. I said, no, they helped him create his whole buzz. his whole wave.
Okay.
They helped him. So that's way different.
Well, all right, so I'm naming some.
Can I just say something to both of y'all real quick? Just say, first of all, y'all both agree that y'all need a team, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
But you agreed talent supersede budget. You agreed you need a budget with the talent.
Yes.
And I don't think that because I know a gang of niggas who blew up without a budget.
No, I'm not saying this. Nothing's definitive. Like, you can't do this without this. That's not.
But you're saying most of the time, take a budget.
Yeah, man.
I'm going to say this. The only reason I could kill you on this, Dev, is this. Please let me talk. $1 million worth of game didn't have no budget. We had Wallow 267, Gilly the Kid, Dev Wade. We had Brian the Calf. We had Nick Rich. We had a great team, no budget. We hit number one in the podcast charts. Number one.
Right.
Listen, teamwork make the dream work, though. We all was pieces of this shit, and it was all our talent. Like, you're great in audio. You're great. Brian is great in the camera work. You're great in being a dickhead. I'm great in just being a great person, an extraordinary individual martial artist, putting that out there, Dojo World. But it's about... It was a team thing. So mm-hmm. I understand what you're saying, Dev. A lot of people do need budgets because a lot of people is generated mm-hmm. and they just don't have that natural thing. Whereas though, like that DMX, he just had that, like Lenny S once said, people got to want to be you or believe in you. Mm-hmm. And that's the next level star.
Right.
So it's like when you looking at us, all we had was each other. We didn't have no money.
Right.
I think with the team thing and everybody extraordinary in their places, like for instance, if you got LeBron James, he had unbelievable trainers. He had people to make sure his health is his eating regimen. He had people to make sure they stretch him. Like, everybody play a part. Even the dude that's passing that water bottle one time. Like, so it's like, if we didn't have the team, it'd be a different drone. But think about this, guys. We did some shit. We hit number one with no corporate backing, none of that shit. Mm-hmm. We ain't got nobody pushing this. We pushed this shit out together. We got together and said, we're going to make some extraordinary shit happen, and that's what we're doing. So the bottom line is, both of y'all writing your own ways, but it's like you mm-hmm. don't always need that budget because a lot of time that budget come after you done did some extraordinary shit.
Right.
And all they doing is just enhancing. Like, all they doing is just enhancing that shit and saying, all right, hold up. You from down North Philly? Are you from down Southwest? You from what's the name? Let me dress you up. You need some money so you can look more like a star. Here goes some money. Now you look like a star. Get your car, get your what's the name,
right.
Put you in a better environment. Put you on this plane, expose you to more things. So now your vernacular becomes spectacular. You got more to rap about. That's what that do, enhance. But when you great, when you got that shit, you gonna get the attention of them. And that's what it's really about, is just getting the attention so you get the help. But a lot of times, them extraordinary motherfuckers, they just be, Mike is extraordinary. LeBron is extraordinary. Them dude, they just extraordinary. And then you got some artists, DMX, the motherfucker was extraordinary. Jay-Z, extraordinary. You got people that's just extraordinary. Drake is just extraordinary. You got mm-hmm. people that just, you know what I mean? Meek Mills, he said, I'm going to get it. Fuck this. He was in a fucked up environment.
Right.
Extraordinary.
Jay-Z had this. We don't use Jay-Z. He's the best rapper ever, and he had the greatest budget ever for out of his own pocket.
Yeah, but still.
He was the opposite. He's actually the anti that. Like, none of the labels wanted him, none of that shit, and he paid out the pocket. You
feel
me?
He came, but I'm just saying. Use him. But I'm talking about these dudes. I'm talking about these dudes was extraordinary.
Right. DMX all day.
So they was just different. So when you look at that, both of y'all got your own right, but like, I always go back to $1 million worth of game. And it's for people that's out there listening and looking. You build it, they will come. You build it because right now we're living in a time and an age where it's though the fucking people is running everything. The people, listen, the root hold up the tree. The root and it's the bottom dictate everything. Now it's about the people. A motherfucker can co-sign you, I'm such and such, but that don't mean that. The people got to really fuck with you. And once you start and you build a relationship with the people mm-hmm. and the people is your family, they going to take you to places you never can imagine. Focus on the people. Don't focus on I need a rap. Everybody, you got rappers fascinated with rappers trying to get. No, don't worry about that. At the end of the day, not too many rappers is going to put you on as a rapper. That's not going to happen. Because if I'm a rapper, I'm still in rapper mode trying to be what's the name? There's only so much they could do to you. And just because somebody a rapper and they in the game, that don't mean they know the game. That don't mean they know the business of music.
Right.
They might just be a worker. And you sitting there, you thinking, oh, I need a rap. No, get the attention of the people. Everybody that could put you in position and put that money in your pocket is that person that's on the bus with you, that person that work with you, that person that's your neighborhood, the mm-hmm. people, and there's a bunch of people that you got to go out there and touch that don't know you. Stop focusing on the stars and focus on the regular people, because the regular people is the reason that the stars are stars, and it's just like that.
Mm-hmm. But like I said, nigga, talent always supersedes everything.
So you so now at this point you saying, nah, fuck that. You'll never take the 360.
Who, me?
Yeah.
I'm not saying I told you I would because I'm telling you where I'm coming from. I'm coming from the young boy.
And they get that nigga anything.
I'm coming from the young boy.
That nigga take anything.
That's living in inner city
Philadelphia. They get a nigga 20 grand and pack of tank tops and some socks. He's signing his life away.
No, they got to throw some do-rags in there for Wavecat Mike, my cousin. But listen.
And they got to put the biggest motherfucking
Oodles and Noodles contract.
If
they throw a fucking Oodles and Noodles contract, I might wave the money.
Endless Oodles?
Like and they let me visit the factory. Like I could be like that could be my sponsor.
Come on, man.
What? Do you know how crazy it is? I could just run around wearing Oodles and Noodles sweatsuits and shit. Like Oodles and Noodles, yeah, they sponsor me. I got the Oodles and Noodles sneaks on. You ain't got these.
You'll be another.
They'll be mad as shit at me. They'd be like, damn, wow, I got the Oodles and Noodles.
No, they would.
The dishes.
They would not be mad at you. They'd be like this nigga.
No, you know what? This is what it'll be.
The Oodles and Noodle Adidas.
No, Oodles and Noodles of Puma. You know, Sneak had the song Oodles. He over there with Puma, and he had the Oodles and Noodles song, the Oodles and Noodles edition. Ooh, with the noodles like the string look like noodles. Ooh.
No, you're not getting no
with the hoodie, the Oodles and Noodle hoodie.
No,
if I gave you Oodles and Noodle hoodie, you won't wear.
I would not wear that shit. I don't eat Oodles and Noodles.
What?
I don't eat Oodles and Noodles.
Nigga, you crazy as hell.
You know I don't eat Oodles and Noodles, nigga.
And you fucking try to cook some Oodles and Noodles for me that time?
Oh, yeah.
And put seasoning on my noodles, you nut ass nigga.
Nigga, I used to put you in the bathtub, nigga. I could put seasoning on
you. That's some spicy
noodles.
Shit. But listen, what I'm saying is, listen,
I used to wash you up, nigga.
If you down the way, I'm gonna ask you something, cuz. If you down the way and you fucked up, and people getting shot every day in the city of America, right? You live in Compton. You live in the south side of Chicago. You live in Harlem. You live in Philly. You live in Atlanta. You live in Miami. You live in Houston. You fucked. It's crazy. And they offer you a 360 to get you some paper so you get, you know, take care of your daughter, secure your family, you and your woman, your mom, do whatever. You going to say no? Who the fuck say that the next label won't come?
My thing is I'm watching niggas be souped up to take a job where it's just like, yo, bro, they going to be giving me like 22 an hour and all of that.
But you know, at the end of the day, I got to know my worth. I was in the same position. I came out of there. I flew down.
But times is hard. This different. He talking about a whole different time.
He had Versace on.
Yeah.
This nigga had you walking up to the rappers with money. We talking about niggas with holes in the back of their
shirts. Like, these young fucked up
so
out
take
here.
The 360, young and fucking sign your life away.
No, I'm not saying this. I'm not telling you that. I'm just saying I said what I do because you bound to get shot any day.
Right, so take the 360s,
or you shoot somebody or go to jail.
Or you
fucked up out here.
Or you could sign your 360 while you're in the hospital, probably recovering from the shots.
From somebody shot you because you posted on the block and you hide the shit for nothing. Yeah. Listen, man, first of all, I want to tell y'all, listen, I can't wait to see y'all. Ain't a lot of tickets left. I can't wait to see y'all.
July 27th. My birthday weekend.
Gilly the Nut birthday weekend.
$1 million worth of game live. Get your tickets right now.
I'm going to get with Planner's Peanuts. See, can they sponsor a cake with just a, you know, Planner's Nuts on there for his birthday. Not on duty. But listen, the whole twist is, I look forward to seeing all our people there, man. We're going to turn all the way up.
July 27th.
I'm getting sauced up. I'm drinking ginger ale on the rocks all weekend.
Hold on, nigga. I know you ain't getting drunk.
No, you should.
I don't do that. Yeah. I'm not getting sauced up.
We're about to spike your shit.
And it's going to be free Reggie on Gil. You know, he's the Reggie man. But listen, man, we turn it up. I look forward to seeing everybody July 27th, man. Get your tickets. If you ain't already, get your tickets. Hit the link in the top of the bio. $1 million worth of game bio. Gilly the King bio. Wallow 267 bio.
Right.
We're turning all the way up, man. Listen,
let me tell you,
man,
something. Get your merchandise.
Get
the
your merchandise
right there.
You see the website, but on top of that, I want to say something. Without you, the one that's looking at this, the one that's listening to this, we won't be number one. There's no us without you.
We're number one.
Teamwork make the dream work, man.
Number
we love y'all. This is $1 million worth of game.
I'm Gilly the King.
I'm Wallow 267.
Just like that.
Right.